welcome to Bray Christian Church. We're so happy that you're here. Would you please stand with us as we begin the worship?
Who remember to turn their clocks forward. Everyone here today, good job. Give yourself a little credit there on that. So we're so glad you're worshiping with us at Bright Christian Church. Would you reach in front of you, take out one of the yellow cards, fill that in, drop that in the on the way out as you leave here. Give us a record that you were with us this morning and communicate anything you need. Your communion set is in front of you there if you want to use that later in our service. It's available. So just want to highlight a couple of things, make you aware. During the month of March, our generosity project is focusing on the work of the local Young Life chapter. And one of our own, Nick Lawrence, is the one heading that up. And so you can give above and beyond your regular giving in any of those silver generosity project boxes, and that will help the work of the students that's going on. Also today we have a special class. It's called Life Mapping. And we all set goals in life and at work, and we need to do that in our Christian lives to help us achieve our fullest potential. So one of our elders, Tony Schroeder, is going to be leading that in the Activity Center. and that'll be at 11:45 today. We'll serve pizza for lunch and have dessert for you, and I know you'll enjoy that and be blessed if you're able to take part in that today. So I'm going to ask if you'd stand right now, and then I'm going to pray for us. We'll continue to worship. Lord, we thank you that even the changing of the hands on the clock reminds us that you are in control of our time, of our lives, of our being. And we rely on you for every breath of air, every beat of our hearts. And so today, we want to use our breath, our heartbeat, our energy to worship you and just say thank you for all you have done for us. In that spirit of gratitude, Lord, we come in your presence right now to worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. in Exodus chapter 3, where Moses is at the burning bush. And the context behind that scripture is God from the burning bush. God from the burning bush. Okay. So this next song that we're about to sing is called The Great I Am. And this core scripture that it's based upon is found in Exodus chapter 3, where God is commanding Moses to go into Egypt and demand from Pharaoh that he let the Israelites go. It's a classic thing, we all know it. But as God handpicked Moses and is charging him with this task, Moses begins to create this list of excuses and these fears he has as to why he is incapable of doing the task that God had given him. And amongst one of these fears, Moses asks the question. He says, God, should I approach the Israelites? Who shall I say sent? Lord, what is your name? And God verbally spoke, probably one of the most memorable passages, quotes that we all know. And God said, tell them, I am who I am. I am who I am. God is speaking of his eternal nature. He's saying, I have always been, I still exist, and I forever will be. None is like me. All things are created through me. I am who I am. And while he was speaking of his eternal nature, he was also pleading with Moses to trust him. He was saying, I am still sovereign over all that I have created. Trust in me, Moses. Believe in me that I have handpicked you for this task. And as we have the privilege this morning of just being able to worship that name freely, to shout that name freely, I encourage you to just think about how great of a statement that is. That we can verbally shout and praise and lift our voices to the great I am. So will you join us now as we partake in the song?
Wanna be close to your side, so heaven is real, death is a lie. I wanna hear voices of angels above, singing as one. Yeah.
us, that it doesn't abandon us. And God, we know we don't deserve it and we can't do anything to earn it. But God, we thank you that you are constantly after our hearts, even when we are not constantly after yours. God, I pray that as Greg comes today to preach, that you would just use him as your vessel to get a message to us. God, let his words be yours, that we would leave here challenged and ready to go change the world for you. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Satan?
Hi. 2020.
Please. Call me 2020. So where are you from?
Hell.
Me too. Call me or save me. I've been feeling so alone. I keep waiting for you, but you never come. Is this in my head? I don't know what to think. He knelt to the ground and pulled out a ring and said, "Marry me, Juliet. You never have to be alone. I love you, and that's all I really know." I talked to your dad, go pick out a white dress. It's a love story, baby. Just say yeah.
I just don't want this year to end.
Who would?
That commercial is very popular. Many people talking about how funny that commercial is. It gets high awards. But the problem with a commercial like that is that it leaves us believing that Satan is not a real figure. He's just a character that we've created. Or that hell isn't even a real place. But if you notice in that commercial, Aaron, let's try to think of his last name. He plays Aaron Reed. He's a bodybuilder turned actor. He plays Satan. And 2020 is personified there in Natalie Roy, the actress. And it's a match made in hell, isn't it? And we make fun of that kind of stuff. And so we make Satan look like he's not real in our culture. Or we make hell look like hell isn't even a real place anymore. It's just something you're going through. Or something that's happening in the world that's tough. Or whatever it is that people make up today. Today what we're going to talk about is hell is a real place and Satan is real. And we want to talk about that today as we continue this journey with Jesus Christ. And God would love nothing more than to remind us that Satan is real. In fact, Satan is mentioned by name, the name Satan, 47 times in the New Testament and Old combined. The devil is used. His name, Diabolos in Greek, meaning the accuser, the one who leads astray, the enemy. He's listed another 33 times as the devil. 80 times, Satan or the devil is listed. He's also used, another term used for him is the prince of this world or the prince of darkness. Satan is real. We need to quit playing games with Satan. Revelation 12:17, Jesus warns that Satan wages war against those who keep God's commands and hold fast their testimony about Jesus. In 2 Corinthians 11:14, the Apostle Paul tells Christians in the church there, Satan masquerades as an angel of light. In John 8:44, if I were to paraphrase that verse, it says that Satan is a liar. He's been a liar from the beginning. And when he speaks his native language. He's a deceiver. He was a deceiver from the beginning. He had influence in heaven. An angel who was created by God to bring him honor and glory to be a messenger of God. And instead of doing what he was created to do, he expressed his free will in pride and arrogance, wanting to be God. And he had influence on other angels. In Revelation 12, we learned that a third of the angels, which means he had influence on a large amount of angels. They were all cast from heaven onto the earth. God judged Satan and those who followed him. Not only did he have influence in heaven, he has influence in the world today, doesn't he? Think about Adam and Eve. When Adam and Eve were given the command by God, do not eat from this one tree. I've created all this for you and it's more than enough. You'll never need anything. And at some point in Genesis chapter 3 verse 1, what does Satan say to Eve? Did God really say? You know, ever since that day when sin entered the world, you know what people say today? Did God really say? Did he really say in his word that you shouldn't live that way, that you shouldn't be in that relationship, that you shouldn't behave the way you're behaving, that you shouldn't desire what you desire to bring pleasure and happiness? And like Eve reached out and at one point bought into that deception, was influenced by Satan. God is withholding something from me that I should want. It's going to bring me happiness, pleasure, going to fulfill my life. Was that true for Eve? No. It's not true for us either when we fall to the deception that Satan puts in our path, where he tries to influence us to go against God's commands. The Apostle Peter, he said this in 1 Peter 5:8, be alert and sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking those he can devour. And not only is Satan real, hell is a real place. And that's something that we need to hear today. Hell is not some difficult thing you're going through in your life. Hell is a real place. And Jesus is going to teach us three particular things here in a few moments. In fact, right now what I want to do is just talk about where Jesus talks about hell in the Bible as a real place. If you and I were to go back to Matthew chapter 25 before we continue in Luke. In Matthew chapter 25, Jesus has taught a parable in the Gospel of Matthew, and he taught this parable about weeds and wheat. Do you remember that? And as he talked about a landowner, a master who went out and planted good seed, that good seed was the believer. God planted the believers in the world. He gave us the ability to follow him. And there are many Christians in the world today, but not as many as we think. He planted good seed. And the servants go out and they say, hey, didn't you plant good seed? And he says, yes, but an enemy has come and planted weeds among the wheat. And the servants go back, believers, and they say, you want us to tear up the weeds? And Jesus says, no, let them both grow up together. And at the harvest, we will bring in the weeds first, bind them up, and throw them in the fire. You know the verse. You know the text. What is the fire? Hell is a literal place. It really exists. And in Matthew chapter 25, he's speaking another parable. He's talking about separating the believer from the unbeliever at the second coming of Christ. He says, on the left will be the goat. That's not the greatest of all time. These are people who are lost, who did not surrender their life to Jesus Christ. And on the right, it's going to be his sheep. And in John chapter 10, Jesus said, my sheep know my voice. You guys know the scriptures. My sheep know my voice. On the right is the believer. And in Matthew 25, 41, Jesus said, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire, separated from the devil and his angels. See, hell was created for Satan and the angels who followed him, who were influenced to do wrong. And it's also reserved for those who follow Satan in the world. And there are so many people today, like Natalie Roy in the commercial, who are dating Satan, and they don't even know it. Turn with me to Luke chapter 16. As we get into Luke chapter 16, verse 19, Jesus here, we're on this road trip with Jesus, and we're looking at the last few weeks of his life leading up to the cross. And then on Easter Sunday, we're going to look at the resurrection. And as we journey with him, we're looking at these conversations and events around Jesus' life. And today we find ourselves in Luke chapter 16, verse 19. Now let me set the stage before we get into this parable that Jesus teaches, an earthly story with spiritual meaning. He's just finished speaking about wealth. And in chapter 16, verse 13, he says, no one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. And then notice verse 14, the Pharisees who loved money heard all this, and they what? Sneered at Jesus. They didn't like what Jesus had to say. And so Jesus teaches this Pharisee. At the beginning of chapter 16, we see Jesus is speaking to his disciples. In 16:14, we see that the Pharisees are there listening, and they're pretty upset with what Jesus has to say. And today, guess what? We have disciples who are listening right now. People who are followers of Jesus, and Jesus wants our attention this morning. And then we have to be reminded, in every crowd there are Pharisees. People who are very legalistic in their faith, and in every crowd there are unbelievers. And that would say that today we probably have all three here. And what Jesus wants us to do, instead of sneering at him, how about this? Listen up. Because look at verse 19. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, and he lived in luxury every day. At the gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. Even the dogs humiliated him. This parable here is very interesting because it starts with this rich man who every day of his life was dressed in rich purple linen. Very wealthy, lived in luxury, never had any want. Who's this a picture of in the story? The Pharisees. And Jesus, again, is trying to get the attention of very legalistic, self-serving people in the culture in the first century. And Jesus would be speaking to us today. If we fall into that category of being legalistic and self-serving. And at the gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores. Now, this is interesting because in parables, you never used names. This would have been a slap in the face to the Pharisees, that leading Jewish religious sect, who should have been looking forward to the Messiah and saying, Jesus is here. And instead they were saying, he's not the political leader we were looking for. And they rejected the Messiah. And Jesus is confronting them right here. And he gives the poor person in need a name. That would have said to the Pharisees that the poor person in need was more important than the rich person in the story. And this would have got their attention. Because here's how Pharisees thought. The wealth that I have, the riches that I have, actually prove my righteousness. That's the way they thought. The more I have, the more blessed my life is. It must mean I'm living right with God. God keeps giving me more. And my riches, my wealth, prove my righteousness. Look how holy I am. And Jesus is saying that's not true at all. Because the beggar here had nothing. And he gives him a name and he says, he is more important than you. Because he's not looking to riches and to wealth to prove his righteousness. Our riches and our wealth will never make us righteous before the living God. In fact, many times what happens is the riches and the wealth that you and I go after actually ends up hindering our relationship with God. We cannot serve two masters. Jeff's going to be speaking a lot more about that next week. But notice what happens here. Even the dogs came to lick his sores. The time came when the beggar died and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried in Hades, verse 23, where he was in torment. I'm going to pause right there. In this story that Jesus tells, an earthly story with spiritual meaning, the poor person, who the Pharisees would have looked at as a loser. No way this person is saved. Look, they have nothing. It proves that they don't follow God. Look at me. I have all these riches. It proves my righteousness. I'm so much better than everyone else. And Jesus flips the script on them. The beggar is in heaven at Abraham's side. Think about how this would have spoke to the Pharisees, that leading religious Jewish sect. Because Jews looked to Father Abraham. They went all the way back to Abraham. Why? He was the beginning. God called him from a foreign nation, from a pagan family. You go to a place I will show you. And God took Abraham to the land of Canaan. Abraham trusted him. And he said, I'll make you a father of many nations. And Abraham had Isaac, and Isaac had Jacob, and Jacob had the 12 sons who became the 12 tribes of Israel, that nation set apart for God. And Jews would say, Father Abraham, because it all started with Abraham's faithfulness. The poor man is the one that gets to sit at Abraham's side. The rich man also died, and he was buried in Hades, where he was in torment. He looked up and he saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this fire." I want to share with you two of the three things that Jesus is teaching us here. And the first is this: Jesus teaches us that heaven is an eternal place of safety, security, and satisfaction. Why? Because God is there. It's an eternal place of safety, security, and satisfaction. And while you and I are looking for satisfaction in this life, there's only one person who can offer satisfaction in this life. His name is Jesus, and he's the only one that can offer us eternity, an eternal place of safety, security, and full satisfaction. But he also teaches, Jesus teaches us this, that hell is an eternal place of suffering. And we don't want to talk about that anymore. Books are now written by pastors who've turned away from this theology that is found in Scripture and that Jesus teaches about so often. Hell is actually mentioned 15 times in the New Testament. Hades is another word for hell. It is mentioned many times. That eternal fire is a term used for hell, or fire. How many times do we see it throughout the New Testament? Many times. Jesus talks about heaven. He talks about hell. Shouldn't we pay attention to hell? You know, people talk about, "I believe heaven's a real place. I want to go. I think I'm good enough." Listen, your wealth, your goodness, your riches, it can never be good enough to get into heaven. Only God, through Jesus Christ, can get you there. Only a relationship with Jesus. And when we delay and we say, "You know what, I'm not going to make a decision for Christ right now," you've actually made a choice by not making a choice to willingly follow Satan. And so many people in the world today are dating Satan, and they have no idea. We try to explain away this place, hell, it's all the bad things that happen in your life. We're living in hell. Believe me, we are not living in hell. And this world was created to be a good place for us. And that the goodness of the Lord is evident in this life. It's not all humdrum. It's not all gloom and doom. God is the goodness in the world. And if people got what they really asked for, if Jesus was really pulled completely out of the world, the Holy Spirit was completely pulled out of the world, this would be a cesspool of darkness. But hell is an eternal place of suffering. This story teaches us something else. Verse 25, "But Abraham replied, 'Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us is and you, a great chasm has been set in place.'" Chasm. Let me correct myself there. Someone on staff corrected me this week. "Greg, that's chasm. I don't want to let them down. There's this great divide, isn't there?" And don't think for a moment that people are going to want to leave heaven and go to hell. But what this says is that people are going to have lost loved ones that they care about. Because notice what the rest of the verse says. "So that those," there's this chasm, "so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us." Here's the third thing that Jesus teaches us, that hell is an eternal place of separation. That will never change. When Jesus comes again and he finds us, believers and unbelievers in the world, judgment will take place, and it's too late. It's too late. For those who have passed from this life before Christ returns and they died rejecting Jesus, they are in hell for eternity in an eternal place of suffering and separation. I don't say that in celebration. I grieve that there are lost people in the world. But God said in the Old Testament to Joshua and his people, "I have set before you life and death. Now choose life. We have a choice to make, church. We have a choice to make, people. Jesus has laid before us life and death. That's why he went to the cross for us. And the choice is ours, whether we follow Jesus or not. And what this story means when he says that there's a chasm that has been set in place so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us. Don't think for a moment anyone's going to want to leave heaven. This is a very deep, detailed story about how it is final. Your decision is final. When you die or when Jesus comes again, the choice is yours. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 2 very quickly. Philippians chapter 2, and the Apostle Paul there, he's writing to the church at Philippi. And when he's writing to them, he speaks about what our attitude should be like. That we should have a humble attitude before the Lord. Then he gets to verse 9. Says this, chapter 2, verse 9, therefore God exalted him, Jesus, to the highest place, and he gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Did you catch that? Every knee will bow in heaven. Those who have died before Jesus comes again, they will bow the knee at the second coming of Jesus Christ. They've already bowed the knee. That's why they're home with the Lord. They're just doing what they've always done. On earth, the believer and the unbeliever alike, whoever's left on earth when Jesus comes again, they will bow the knee. It will be too late for the unbeliever. They have chosen to be separated from God for eternity. And when they bow, it's going to be like, I made a grave mistake. And under the earth, what is that speaking of, church? Hell, those who have already died rejecting Jesus Christ, they will bow the knee saying, I made a mistake. I rejected the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hell is a real place. Satan is real. And notice how he responds next in the story. The rich man, he answered, then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my family, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them so that they will not also come to this place of torment. Abraham replied, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them. No, Father Abraham, he said, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. He said to him, if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead. In other words, Jesus is making a point. You don't need anything else. You don't need any more signs. You don't need any more miracles. In fact, Jesus confronted people and he said, you wicked generation, you always need a sign. People, even when they get a sign, always needed more. We have enough. We have more than enough. Simply from Jesus and the Word of God, we have more than enough to make a decision today for Jesus Christ. When I was born in the 1970s, I was born in 1972. In 1971, there was a band that came along by the name of Led Zeppelin. Anyone know this band? Speaking some of your language, I'm dating all of us that just said yes. Led Zeppelin. They came out with a song, a famous song, and the lead singer of Led Zeppelin, Robert Plant, right? He co-wrote with Jimmy Page. Am I right? You keep me on track here, Tom. He co-wrote Stairway to Heaven. Became a very famous song, and there's a phrase in that song that begins the song and it ends the song. She's buying the stairway to heaven. In the late 70s, there was another band that had become famous, AC/DC, this Australian rock band. And they became famous, and they had a new lead singer in 1979 by the name of Bon Scott. Bon Scott helped co-write with another bandmate the song Highway to Hell. And Highway to Hell, people don't know this, if you research the song, it had nothing to do with a real place. They considered life on the road hell, and if you study why they wrote that song, one of the bandmates said, if you wake up with Robert Plant's sweaty socks after a show in your face 2 inches away because of the close proximity on a bus, he said, it is a highway to hell. But then there was this graphic, this cartoon that came up, and I thought this was speaks exactly what I wanted to share with you today. And it's this cartoon of Robert Plant and Bon Scott walking together. And here's this highway to heaven on the left. And here's, or I'm sorry, stairway to heaven on the left. And here's the highway to hell on the right. And Robert Plant says to Bon Scott, he says, we split ways here. And as I looked at that meme, that cartoon, or how do you say that? Is it meme or who knows? We were trying to figure that out. That graphic, that cartoon, here, it just makes this graphic point to us. There is no stairway to heaven, but there is a highway to hell. There is no stairway to heaven. She's buying the stairway to heaven. You can't buy the stairway to heaven. You can't be good enough. You can't have enough money. You can't have enough resources. It's a gift freely given by Jesus Christ. And it's our choice whether we choose life or we choose death. But if we choose death, understand that it is eternal separation in hell, in torment. It is suffering. It is separation for eternity. It is our choice. And the worst part of hell isn't the suffering. It's the fact that God is not there, and you will never, ever be in a relationship with God again by choice. By choice. And there are so many churches and pastors and Christians who are teaching it's not true. And we find ways to make it a cartoon, and it's not a cartoon in Scripture. It's real. And Jesus is warning us today. Well, you can't buy a stairway to heaven. But you can be on the highway to heaven. In fact, in Matthew chapter 7, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus, he gives us two roads. This longest recorded sermon of Jesus in Matthew. Chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, Jesus said, enter. Since we're on this road trip with Jesus, I love this because it speaks of the road we're on. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. What's that tell us? Many people choose what? Choose the highway to hell. But small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. And the choice is ours. We can be on a highway to hell, or we can choose the highway to heaven. And you know what? I love you enough to say I care about your salvation. And I want to be in heaven with you someday. And we can be on the highway to heaven when we take four essential steps. I'm going to share these with you now. You can write these down in your bulletin, on your notes. Number one, we have to believe that Jesus is the only way to heaven. He's the only way. When Jesus, on the last night of his life in John 14, he's speaking to two disciples, Philip and Thomas, and he's saying, hey, I'm about to go home. I'm about to go to heaven. If I go there, I'm going to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house are many rooms. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back for you. I will take you home someday. And they're like, well, how do we get there? And he says, you know the way. How do we know the way, they ask. And he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father except through me. John 14:6. Jesus, in that moment, for all of history, removes any religion that says that they lead anyone to heaven. Jesus said it, and I believe it. He is the only way for someone to experience a reconciled relationship with God the Father. He's the only way. In Acts 4:12, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. I was sharing with someone last week, you know, the Christian faith is the only faith that is not a religion. We use the word religion, it's actually misused. We are not a religion. It's actually the only faith that leads to a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's actually the only faith that is relationship based with God. So we need to stop using religion for Christianity. It's actually a relationship. You and I are not in a religion. We are in a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Amen. We have to believe that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Number two, we have to repent from unholy, sinful living. We have to repent from sinful living. In Acts 2:38, as Peter, he preaches after receiving the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, and he becomes the rock that Jesus knew he would become. He stands and he preaches so boldly, full of the Holy Spirit, and he sends this convicting message to the Jews who were there at the crucifixion, crucifying Jesus. It says they were cut to the heart at his preaching. In other words, they were convicted. And then they said to Peter and the other brothers, what should we do? What do? We have this conviction. We know we were wrong. We killed the Messiah. We rejected him. Now we believe that he is who he said he was. And Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Repent. Repentance comes first. And so we have to repent from sinful living. That word repent is a compound word in the Greek. It's metanoia. It means to change the mind. When we change the way we think, it changes the way we live. And repent is literally a U-turn. It's a 180. I'm going the wrong direction. I realize I'm on the wrong track. God is calling me to turn to Him. And that's what repentance looks like. There are four things that God got my attention on early on in my faith. And I repented of those four big things in my life. And since then, God has been working on many others. Is that your story?
Yes.
Repentance. Here's number three. We have to confess Jesus as Lord. We have to confess Jesus as Lord. In Romans 10:9, the Apostle Paul, he said, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, Master, that word in the Greek means Master, you confess He is Lord, and you believe that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. You see how the process of salvation works? You have to believe, you have to repent, you have to confess. This confession is an invitation to Jesus. It's confessing Him as Lord, inviting Him into your life to sit on the throne, to lead and guide your life through the Word of God. And I remember the night that I fell to my knees and I prayed to God over 2 decades ago. I said, Jesus, would you come into my life and clean up the mess I made? I want to follow you the rest of the days of my life. That's the invitation. I want you to be the Lord of my life. Sit on the throne. Teach me how to live. It's really that simple. And here's number four. We have to be baptized. We have to be baptized. Romans 6:1-4. In Romans chapter 6, Paul, he's speaking to believers there in Rome. And when he speaks about baptism, he asks them some questions. He says, what shall we do? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? He says, by no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death. We were therefore buried with Him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too can live a new life. Baptism is essential because it is a public burial of the old life. And if it wasn't essential in Acts 2:38, Peter wouldn't speak to people who were convicted already, because who convicts people and cuts them to the heart? Who convicts them? The Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit was already convicting, but then He tells them, what should you do? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You see, the Holy Spirit convicted every one of us before we surrendered our life. That's what He does. He convicts the world of sin. But surrendering our life to the Holy Spirit, that's a completely different thing. When we are baptized, buried, baptizo in the Greek means to be dunked, plunged, or covered, to be buried. And when we bury the old life, there's a regeneration of the heart. And we come up out of that water, it is the obedience, like Noah in 1 Peter chapter 3, where Peter brings up the obedience that Noah had. The water that saved Noah. How did the water save Noah? He was obedient to building a ship over 100 years in the desert where there had never been rain. Had he not built that ship and gotten on that, he wouldn't have been saved by water. He would have died by that same water. How are we saved? By obedience, being buried with Christ in water and raised to new life. Romans 6:4. Just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too can live a new life. We have to take those four essential steps. And if you think, I've heard this before, I've heard the process of salvation, I've given my life to the Lord, great. Most Christians are not confident to walk someone else through. Take this tool and learn it, memorize it, use it to share the gospel message with those around you in its fullness to bring people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. In that commercial, there was a scene where Satan, Aaron Reed, he takes the cell phone and he takes a selfie in front of a what? A dumpster fire. A lot of people say, oh, that was hell. 2020 was a dumpster fire. Well, let me tell you that life without Jesus, the pictures in our life are going to be a dumpster fire. But our picture of eternity, it's going to be far worse than a dumpster fire if we reject Christ before and refuse to give our life to Him before it's too late. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your word today that teaches us boldly. Hell is real and heaven is real. And you have laid life and death before us. The choice is ours. We understand that judgment is a time where we get what we ask for. So Lord, if there's even one person in this room who's refused or delayed laying their life down, giving their life to you, Jesus, I pray that they would come forward, they would make a decision, they would sit, go through the process of salvation, surrender their life, and experience an eternal relationship with you, both in the world today and in eternity to come. As it's often been said, eternity is a long time to be wrong. And so we pray, God, that you would bring people to the Lordship of Jesus Christ in His church. It's in the powerful name of Jesus we pray, we say together. Amen. If you have a decision to make, I'm going to step forward. You could come and meet me up here. We'll get you to the Next Steps team, and they'll be able to help and guide you in any way that you need.
And wonder how we could love.
shall see. Will be my joy through the ages to sing of His love for me. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
As we prepare for this time of communion, I want to go back and read the second verse from the song we just sang. And it says this: He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them His very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. And that's just a perfect summary of everything Jesus did for us. He took on all of our sins, took them away from us, bore the weight of that, and suffered and died, but was resurrected so that we could have eternal life with Him. That is the greatest gift that could ever be given. If you're not a believer at this time, I just want you to think about your next steps and what it will take for you to take that next step with your relationship, to a fully committed relationship with Christ. And if you are a believer, I want you to think about what Jesus did for us and how He suffered alone so that we could live with Him. I want you to pray about that right now, and then we'll come back together and take communion. While Jesus was eating with His disciples, He took the bread and He gave thanks for it, and He broke it, saying, "This is my body. Take it and eat." And in the same way, He took the cup, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "This is my blood poured out for you." So thankful that You suffered for us, that You took all of our sin and bared the weight of it on Your own so that we could live with You in heaven forever. You love us so much, and for that we are so, so thankful, and we love You and we thank You. And it's a debt we can never repay. You're so gracious. It's in Your Son's name we pray. Amen. Let's sing that chorus again.
How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
How many of you have kids in children's ministry right now? Or when you go back, tell Mandy I said I'm sorry. But also, aren't you grateful that we have children's ministry now, first service as well? So grateful for what they're doing. A couple quick announcements before we leave. Sign up for the seniors trip. Ends tomorrow, so please make sure that you call into the office and sign up for the seniors trip to the Creation Museum. Jeff will be leading that trip. We have an Easter invite right up on the Information Center desk. On the back of that, Linda has created a card to hand off to someone to invite. On the back, we're challenging you just to write a personal note to that person and invite them to Easter service. And right after service today, join me for Tony Schroeder's life mapping class, Set New Goals in Your Life to Grow Spiritually. Let me pray. Father, we're grateful to be here today, and Lord, as we go out, we share time with people this week, wherever we are, would we be the hands and feet of you, Jesus Christ, in the world today? People are desperate for hope, and you're the only hope the world has. Help us to be a hope that shines bright. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.